Sweet, cool. Thank you, Kara. Welcome, everybody. Welcome, welcome to our Spring 2021 Next Gen Celebration. We're so excited to have you all here with us to celebrate and showcase the very hard work of our students this past semester. This has been now our third semester that's been entirely virtual since the start of the pandemic, which is crazy. I think we've all lived 10 lives or so over the past 4 months. So much has happened, so much has changed, and throughout it all, these next-gen students managed to come to virtual class twice a week and complete our program on top of their other school commitments, on top of their other home commitments, on top of their most important job, which has been to keep their minds and their bodies and their spirits healthy during this really bizarre and demanding time. So bravo. I cannot overstate how impressive you all are and how proud we are of all of you. All right, so we're gonna kick this off by introducing our youth programs team, and then we'll go down the agenda, some best practices, and get right down to it. I can introduce myself first since I'm already blabbing away and then pass it along. My name is Faye Terry. I'm the youth programs coordinator here at BAVC. I mainly move a lot of pieces behind the scenes, but celebration night is always very gratifying for me because I get to see these pieces finally come together, thanks to all of you. So thank you all for your hard work. I'm gonna pass it off to Jay to introduce herself.
Awesome. Hi everyone, welcome to our Spring 2021 Next Gen Celebration. My name is Jay Gash. I'm the Associate Director of Youth and Emerging Media Maker Programs, as well as the creative producer for our youth productions team that we're developing. I've been with BAVC for about 5 years now, but it's just been a really wonderful experience being able to provide different opportunities like these programs for our young people. So not only, and you'll hear more from the instructors, but not only do they have the opportunity to learn about the technical skills of video production, audio production, game code design, and animation, they're also supported in a safe and supportive environment. So they're really developing their socio-emotional awareness and being able to tackle those hard conversations and have a greater understanding of themselves. Outside of the work that I do to support these programs, I'm also a filmmaker photographer, and I'm really excited for all the work that is being shown this evening, and congratulations to all the students who have participated across these 14 weeks. You did a wonderful job. Congrats.
Thank you, Jay. You'll see on your screen John Valdez and Carolina Escuela. They're both two very valuable members of the youth programs team who can't make it right now. Kata will pop in at the end and introduce herself. Dawn's our Director of Youth and Emerging Media Makers, and Kata is our Youth Engagement Specialist, and we're so grateful to them. Wherever they are out there, I know where they are, but we're grateful to them. Next slide.
Out on Mount Everest.
Thank you, Robert. Okay, best practices. These are all things that we're familiar with at this point, but just a few reminders to keep in mind. Please keep your mics muted. If you've got feedback for our students or questions or just want to give props or applause or say some random things, that's great. Please do that in the chat. We love that. We want to keep our chat alive all night long, and we'll be keeping an eye on it. So keep the chat alive. Be mindful of your airtime. Tonight's really all about our students and celebrating them. So let's give them the floor. 3 hours is a long time to sit and stare at a screen. We totally get that. So please get up, stretch, get some food, make some food, bring your laptop along with you, take us around your house, grab a squeeze ball, whatever you need to do to take care of yourself and in order to be present with us and watch our student work, please do that. Most importantly, have grace with yourself and with others. BlueJeans is a pretty new platform for a lot of us. Tech issues are gonna arise, maybe on our end, maybe on yours. Just roll with it, it's all good at this point. We eat tech issues for breakfast. BlueJeans 101. A few helpful tips about BlueJeans. As I mentioned earlier, you can view and use the chat feature, which should just pop up if you hover your mouse on the right-hand side of the screen. You can either chat with a whole group or DM someone, direct message someone in the audience. You can go crazy with emojis and reactions. If you move your mouse to the right-hand side, you should see the option to do a clap. You can also do a couple other fun things in there. One important thing to note is that when we get to the point in the night when we're sharing students' work, there will be a sliding toolbar that pops up on your screen in the lower left-hand corner. Most of us won't have to touch this sliding toolbar at all. Things are going to be peachy. A few of us might have trouble seeing the videos. If that happens to you, just slide that toolbar all the way from the left to the right. If you have any issues with that, you can also DM me and I can kind of walk you through that. Next slide, Jay. The agenda. This is what tonight's going to look like. We did our welcome. We're going to do a little rewind on the program, share a bit about what you all worked on. Then we're going to get right into sharing students' work. That's going to be the bulk of the night. We'll do some very quick announcements and thank yous at the end. We'll be out of here by 7. Next slide. Sweet. All right, so we're really lucky to have Paula in the audience, who's our executive director. She's in the house and she's just going to say a few words about BAVC as a whole. Hi, Paula.
Hi, Faye. Thank you. Hi, everybody. As Faye said, I'm so happy to be here. I'm BAVC's executive director and I get the pleasure of working with this awesome team that you've gotten to know this semester and to support the instructors. So happy that they're with us. And I'm so happy you're here. And that's really what I wanted to say is that you are part of BAVC's media making community. And we go really deep. We have people that have come to take their first media making class or they worked on their first film at BAVC that really span all kinds of places, including, I just learned, the current head of Pixar and like their president. And I just talked to a woman this week who runs the filmmaking program at Cal Arts, which is like this really prestigious arts program, university in Southern California. And she's like, I developed my first film at BAVC. So you're part of our network, and we really hope that you'll stay with us and continue to come back, whether it's coming back if you're still within the age range for next gen, or if you want to come into the Bridges Fellowship and apply for that opportunity, or take classes with us and get a certificate. There's all kinds of ways to stay plugged in and to continue developing as a media maker. So thank you and welcome and stick with us. Okay, can't wait to see your films. Bye.
Thank you, Paula. I miss bumping into you in the office. Okay, that was an overview
of
BAVC as a whole. A little bit more about NextGen specifically. So this program is made up of four tracks, four classes. Tonight you're gonna meet students from our game code design track, our audio production class, which we call Bump, our animation class, and our video production class, which we call Factory. And over the course of the past semester, our students did kind of a turbo speed deep dive into their particular mode of media making. They were also visited by guest speakers. They got to be part of our youth program's career panel. A lot of them had their rough cuts of their projects critiqued, and they learned how to give and receive feedback, which is a really important skill. They all around built really tight-knit communities in their virtual classrooms that I'm always impressed by. The overarching goal of the past semester has been to really offer students a set of skills that they can use to express themselves, use as tools to advocate for social justice work, and then also really to expose them to what's possible in the professional media making industry. And I really do believe that every student in this program right now is capable of being a part of this industry, and we hope through this program to really chip away at the barriers to accessing that industry and build confidence in our young people so that it's their voices that we hear in the podcasts of tomorrow and their faces that we see in the films and the shows that we watch and their characters and stories that we're interacting with in the games that we play. So hopefully our students are walking away with a bit more confidence than they came in with. Okay, all that being said, it's time now to introduce our incredible team of instructors who truly make this program what it is. I swoon over them every day. We're going to start with our bump instructor, Robert.
Hello. So yeah, my name is Robert. I'm an electronic musician and DJ. I've been DJing for about 10 to 12 years, about a decade now. But yeah, BAVC is amazing. I've been with BAVC since 2012. I started off as a Bridges student, so that should tell you how, you know, how much I love this program and, you know, the community for the most part. The community is like, will get you very far. And up next, we got my very good friend, Miriam.
Hello, I'm Miriam. I'm a multidisciplinary designer based in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. I've been the game code instructor at BAVC for about 2 years now, and I've been really enjoying it and loving to see like how all my students develop their voices and their visual communication skills and just their sense of humor as well. And I'll pass it off to Valentina.
Hi, everybody. I'm Valentina. I'm from Brazil. I'm a poet and an experimental animator, and I'm the animation instructor. And I've been here, this is my second semester at BAVC, and I'm loving it. And it's such a special opportunity, and everyone here is so special and so cool. And it's just like super rewarding for everybody involved. I'm going to pass it off to Jess.
All right. What's up, everybody? I am Jess. I'm the factory instructor. I've been involved in filmmaking and video production for over 10 years now. Super happy to call BAVC home for, I think it's been about a year, if not a little bit more, and really excited to celebrate everybody's hard work tonight.
Thank you, Jess. Thank you, instructors. Now we're going to get into what we're all really here for. We're going to start sharing our student work. We're going to start with game code design. So I'm going to pass it to Miriam to share a bit more about their class.
Thanks. So this semester in game code, students explored mental well-being and storytelling by developing 2D side-scroller games set in San Francisco. So a time traveler from the distant future, which is our player, moves through the city, stopping to engage in playful dialogue with other characters. The students worked in Adobe Illustrator to design a library of unique non-player characters and game assets, and also proceeded to develop game environments and mechanisms for gameplay in Unity 3D game engine. So up first is Donna.
Hey everybody, my name is Donna, and this is my game. A world of flowers, blocks, and cities, huh? If this is your type of game, then keep looking, because this game isn't it. This is a world populated with people, all with different personalities. So much so that gravity doesn't work either. Let's explore, player. And in this game, we made a lot of sprites, and this was one of the sprites that I made, and his name is Bob. Heya, I'm Bob, and I work here at that cafe over there. I'd like to say I'm a casual dude who loves his customers and their money. Can't wait to see you in this game. And here's a little snippet of the game.
Up next is Sally.
Okay, my game is about when a traveler from the future mysteriously lands in modern-day San Francisco and has to find a way back. On his journey, he meets the strange and unique people that inhabit the city. Can you get back home? And the character I made was Karen. Karen is buying a hot dog stand from this hot dog stand that I made, and she complains that her hot dog bun has too much bun and wants a refund. She prevents you from ordering your hot dogs and throws insult at the hot dog owner. Fortunately, she has to go to her tribal game.
And up next is Sahil.
Hi everyone, my name is Sahil, and today I'm going to be introducing my character. So first of all, some lore behind the story. You've been selected to visit the Arctic in the far future, but your malfunctioning time machine takes you to the past. Talk to the locals, make friends, and find a way home. So one of the characters I made was Mrs. Elizabeth. And Mrs. Elizabeth is a kind old woman who lives in one of the antique painted ladies' homes in a cell. Ever since her children grew and moved out, she's always been rather lonely and would care for some company. You'll be treated to some warm tea and crumpets if you do.
And up next is Eden.
Hi there, my name's Eden. I'm a student in game code. My project description starts with whoosh, whoosh. Mysteriously, you have been warped through time. There is no clear way out, you say to yourself. This place looks familiar, futuristic even. It seems you have gone through into the future. Find a way out. One of the characters I designed is named Alfred. Alfred, a business tycoon in SF, financial district, money hungry, and frequently visits the casino. Hears news about a time traveler in town and curiously confronts them.
And up next is Christina.
Hi, I'm Christina, and first off, I'm going to start with a description of my game. Join time traveler Ailey from 2104, going back in time to 2019 to explore the beautiful, eye-catching, and unpredictable city of San Francisco. Meet locals and witness amazing scenes of the prominent city, meeting people ranging from teenagers to grandparents and students to scammers. Gain bonds, perspectives, and leave with a lasting interactions. My character's name is Henry Singh, and the 80-year-old man is reserved and lonely, resides in Chinatown, and often sits around Washington Square every day, observing the children play with their families while missing his own. The sense of family that he never got to experience, but he has his little friends around him to keep him company.
And then we have Ian.
Hi, I'm Ian. So in my game, from the far future, a time traveler's time device travels from the future and malfunctions, sending them to the present in San Francisco. They must navigate through the city to find a way home. And the character I made for the game is called David. He's a tired cashier, annoyed with the player, and would rather prefer if you leave him alone.
And then last but not least, we have Katie.
Hi, I'm Katie. So what is my game about? As beautiful as the year 2021 sounds, we're still in a global pandemic, causing people to stay distanced from others. Out of nowhere, a time traveler from the future hits San Francisco, looks at his watch, and checks the year. He meets people along his journey through the city and explores different buildings while the adventure awaits for him. The NPC I created is Samantha, and she's an angel in her early 20s who's optimistic, outgoing, and loves interacting with others. She even owns a Chinese restaurant.
Thank you, Katie. So next slide, please. Cool. So this semester in Game Code, we've not only been able to connect across pandemia, but also time zones. We've played games every week, made games, and also told stories, did role play and lots of things to kind of connect with each other, get to know each other, and develop our own styles of communication and storytelling. So I'm really excited to show you our projects. We'll also share the link for all their games in the chat in a second. So it's playable in browser. Thank you.
for checking that out. But also like to acknowledge Joshua Vasquez and Echo and Isabella Juan, who also worked really hard on their projects this semester. Thank you.
Thank you, Miriam. Congratulations, Game Code Design students. Incredible work. Is it weird that I watch your class Zoom recordings to learn things? Maybe. But it's so impressive. We're so proud of all of you. All right, up next, we're going to pass it to Robert. Bumps it up.
Yes. Can you guys hear me? All right, so this semester, students were basically just focusing on telling their own stories, you know, through their own voices, whether it was through an interview and or their struggle through tackling a new sport, or was it tackling a, you know, new dance crave? Who knows? But first up, we got Piero with his experience with Muay Thai.
Yeah, hello, my name is Piero, and my story is about my experience doing Muay Thai.
Thank you, Piero. How are you doing today? On this fine Friday?
Alright, so I'm going to talk about my experience with Muay Thai. This was around a year ago in January, right before the whole pandemic thing really got bad. First of all, you gotta know that I have no prior experience with like a striking martial art, like boxing or Muay Thai. Never done that before. Well, other than fighting my brother in the backyard. Or rather, getting my ass kicked by my brother. But that's besides the point. Okay, so I'm talking to my friend about the UFC and stuff, right? Then he mentions a Muay Thai place he goes to. It's actually pretty close to where I live. He says pretty good, so I'm interested. One thing led to another, and now I'm begging my mom to take me there. You know, I order my boxing gloves, my hand wraps, my shin pads, all the stuff I need for the class, right? So I go there, I see my friend, ask him about the class and just this type of stuff we're going to do. Then I meet the instructors and the rest of the students. But then I have my eye on one specific kid. The dude's name is Jama, some huge kid that's already done a few amateur fights and he's dominated them. As soon as I heard about him, you already know that guy was a target for me. So the class ended, you know, whatever. I was kind of confused. I didn't really know what I was doing, but it was fun. So I wanted to go back. I went back a week later and I started getting the hang of stuff. I started making some friends, learning the technique, and obviously I rose to the top of the group behind a few students, and one being Jama. I didn't have anything out for him, he was a cool dude, but I'm just very competitive, so. At this point, I'm like 2 weeks in, six sessions into the class, and I was told that it was going to be a sparring day. We weren't doing full sparring, it was kind of light, but it's still sparring, so I was still excited. Now, they put me against my original friend first, but it was kind of unfair because he's pretty short. I'm way taller than him, so I beat his ass. Then they put me against some 10-year-old. Alright, now hear me out. I didn't want to kill the kid, so I went light on him. But I still take pride in controlling the fight. I guess you can call it that. After sparring those water boys, I finally got some real competition. I forget her name, but she was some really tall girl that's been there for a few years, so she knew what she was doing. But you know me, and I ain't no my producer said I can't say that. Alright, but anyway. Yeah, she was doing pretty good at the beginning of the fight, and then the instructor decided to step in. He said, hey, you two can hit each other in the head now. So I was excited. Before, they were only allowing us to do body shots, but because we're a little bit ahead of the class, we were an exception. As soon as he said that, I started dominating the fight, hitting left and right, combos. I'm insane. Before I continue, I do not condone hitting women. But I won, right? Now I look up, and I see my next opponent, Jama. I've been waiting for this. So we do a quick bow before we start sparring, and then we start. Now I'm taking it slow because this kid's pretty good. I don't want to take any chances. You know, I'm struggling a bit because this dude's throwing 360s, doing like double backflips and stuff. I've never seen it, so I'm really confused. He hits me a couple of times while I've just been pillow punching him. So I say, you know what? Enough's enough. And I pop him in the face where his headgear isn't protecting him. Now the sparring ends. We're not mad at each other, but you know, we have more respect towards each other now. And I stayed for the adult class, and oh man, that didn't really end too well.
I really appreciate that. As a former wrestler, that was great. Great work. I think up next we got Max. But yeah, Piero, we might have to hit the mat a little, you know.
Hi, I'm Tammy, and this is a short video compilation of the memories, practices, hardships, and performances that my dance crew and I shared and how we chose to navigate the pandemic.
Thank you, Tammy. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Tammy, and if you know me, you probably know that I'm on a dance team. I hate it. All of it. It's the worst thing I've ever put myself through. Just kidding. Honestly, practicing with them is always a highlight of my very boring weeks, but it was actually pretty awkward the first time we ever danced together. We're all from different schools, and it was my first time dancing with them, so you can guess how well our first practice went. To break the ice, we had a couple team bondings, including this one time when we went to dinner and karaoke. We got scammed out of $200, but we made a lot of good memories, so it wasn't a total loss. We began last year, so we're still pretty new. I was in another dance group before this, but I left for many personal reasons. Anyway, we have 9 people in our group, but we started with 3, and I guess you could call us a subunit of sorts. We do whole group dances, but we always try to incorporate trio dances into the mix. As a group, we only practice once a week because we're all pretty busy. This is kind of a problem because that means we only have 2 days to learn 4 to 5 dances and clean them, so our practices can run anywhere from 5 to 9 hours long. Our practice days are the only thing that I really look forward to during the week because it's so fun, and we're constantly laughing every time we make mistakes, but it can honestly feel like torture sometimes because we do so many floor moves that we always leave practice with bruised and bleeding knees. Speaking of practice, we're all pretty broke, so we can't afford to rent a studio every week, which means we have to go to a nearby park and use the windows as mirrors. That sounds really sad, the more I think about it. But it's okay. And really, we don't even get paid for the performances we do, but we go all out anyway and spend a lot of money on performance outfits. So after all that, you might be wondering, why would we do that to ourselves? Honestly, it can be really hard being on a dance team with so many people because there are always going to be arguments and frustrations. But I love them, and everyone is so passionate about dancing and dancing together, so we're always able to fundraise a lot of money for a great cause and have a lot of fun along the way. So in the end, it's all worth it.
Thank you, Tammy. Appreciate it so much. Such a great attribution to the class. Up next, I believe we have Max Bimbo, but honestly, let's give it up for Tammy. Come on now. Let's give it up for Tams.
Oh yeah, good video. My name is Max, and my project is me interviewing my dad about his time living in Palau.
Thank you, Max. Also, the beast.
My name is Max Bembo, and this is my dad, Scott Bembo. Today, we're going to be talking about his experiences living overseas in Palau. So tell me why you decided to move to Palau.
I was practicing law in Boston for a couple of years after law school, and I didn't enjoy it very much. And started to look for interesting work overseas, and then ended up in the island paradise of Palau after that. It's about 500 miles east of the Philippines and about 500 miles north of the northernmost islands of Indonesia. So it's really far away from here.
What was your job and what did you do in it?
I started out in the Attorney General's office in Palau, working as an assistant attorney general. And then for part of my time there, I was the lawyer for the president of the country. And I ended up also working as a lawyer for the Minister of Justice of Palau.
What is the most interesting project that you worked on?
The president called me into his office and asked me if I knew anything about diplomatic relations with other countries. And he told me that his administration was going to be entering into formal diplomatic relations with the Philippines. And he asked me to draw up all of the necessary documents that would enable Palau to begin diplomatic relations with the Philippines. And it turned out that a delegation arrived from the Philippines that Friday. And by the end of the weekend, we were in formal diplomatic relations between Palau and the Philippines.
So you mentioned diving. Where did you like to dive in Palau?
It's a dive that had just about everything you could imagine on a tropical scuba dive. You would start out at a place called the Blue Hole, which was the entrance to it was about as large, maybe a little bit larger than this room. And you'd sink from the surface of the ocean through this blue hole. It was probably 50 feet from top to bottom. At the bottom of the blue hole, it would open up into a massive underwater cave. So you'd dive through the cave, and then you'd come to a place at the end of the dive called Blue Corner. It was a pretty intense ocean current at that place. And we'd actually take these hooks and hook them into the parts of the reef that were safe to hook into. And then those were tied around our waists. And we would just sit there for maybe 10 minutes watching the sea life in front of us. Often when I was at Blue Corner, I would have sharks longer than you are tall about this far away from me.
What was the most beautiful thing you saw while diving?
Some of the fish in Palau had colors that I can't even describe with normal names of colors because they were so vibrant. I also did a lot of night diving with a flashlight. And when you're night diving and everything is completely dark except what's in front of your flashlight, and you get even different vibrant colors that way.
What do you think the biggest issue facing the ocean right now is?
I think the biggest issue with the ocean is pollution. And I think that a big part of that problem is that regulating the use of the oceans is so weak compared to the damage that can be done to the ocean. I studied marine law, and I practiced a lot of marine law when I was in Palau. And it's really difficult for a tiny country like Palau, and even a huge country like the United States, to protect its fishing areas from outsiders, from people coming in and just plundering the oceans. And when I was in Palau, friends of mine who worked in the Attorney General's office prosecuted cases against fishermen, Chinese fishing vessels that illegally came into Palau waters and tried to steal fish and then get out. And we would catch them constantly and learned the contents of the garbage gyres around the world, and learning that 46% of it is fishing equipment, fishing nets, was just astonishing.
How do you think we can help the ocean?
Being aware of what we're taking out of the ocean and how we're taking it out of the ocean is really important. The amount of litter and junk in the ocean is astonishing. The ways that fishing companies are taking fish out of the ocean is just incredibly irresponsible.
So thank you for allowing me to interview you. For the Bay Area Video Coalition, my name is Max Benbow.
Thank you, Max. I really appreciate that. That was amazing.
Woo! Great job, BUM students. I'm so impressed you had an audio class and then you all had video production on top of that. So watch out, factory.
Ooh.
Not enough.
But up next, what we got next? What is it?
Animation.
Hey, everybody. Okay, so in animation this semester, the students learned about different animation techniques and styles through tiny little projects, and then they set off to work on their own short films. And they were encouraged to explore subjects that they were passionate about using the techniques that best supported each individual subject matter. Well, we can go to the next one. These are a couple things that we learned how to do in class. So editing audio and video on Premiere, storyboarding, and understanding the production pipeline of animation, and like the different production pipelines depending on what kind of animation you want to do. Animating through drawing and stop motion, giving and receiving critique, free writing, using references for and drawing for animation, working smart and planning ahead, and trying to cut on the absurd amount of hours that animation takes to be done, and drawing inspiration from anything, including each other. We can go to the next slide. So Axel is not here, he's our first student, so I'm just gonna read his project description. His project is called Runaway, and here's the description. When being alone with our issues, we want to do nothing but run away, especially when our resources are limited and we are stuck with nothing but our thoughts. But what happens to our problems if we ignore them? Do we just magically disappear? Or do they become something worse that will inevitably take over? We'll find out. So we can go to the next slide. And Sochi's gonna talk a little bit about her project. What is yours, Sochi?
My project is about how migrants are treated in around the world and like for being who they are. And that's why I named my title, Who You Are.
Thank you, Sochi. Okay, so next up would be Andrea. Andrea's also not here, so I'm gonna read her description. The name of her project is Fluorescent Tone, and here's the description. My project is about the life cycle of a weeping wallow tree. It is supposed to show the time lapse of one day, but in reality, it's multiple years. It shows how the death of one tree can lead to the birth of many others. And we're gonna go ahead to the next person, who is Mary.
Hello, my name is Mary, and my film is called Flower. It is about the euphoric feelings and heartbreak in relationships. Thank you.
A very beautiful film. Next up, we have Nehemiah here to talk about his project.
Okay, so my project is about equality and how dragging people down or simply just causing conflict between the ones that are not equal is not going to be good for anyone.
Really cool film too. All right, so next up we got Isabel.
So my film is about accepting who you are, and instead of conforming to the current beauty standards, we should understand that what makes you unique makes you beautiful.
Thank you, Isabel. All right, guys, so now, okay, actually, I just wanted to put a picture of, like, in the first day of class, we did emojis describing, like, how we saw ourselves or how we were feeling at the time. So this is how we started. And if we go to the next slide, that's how it's going. Yay, look at us. We're so cute and accomplished. And we learned so much this semester. Okay, so now we're going to watch a reel with every single film, kind of like a tiny little animation show. So you guys can just kick back and relax and enjoy our students, their work. Thank you.
emergency. The CDC now predicting death could hit as many.
Hi. It's pretty clear that my thing isn't done. School got in the way and a bunch of other stuff and also graduation. Hooray. But yeah, I definitely want to keep on working on it. And I just want to thank the people at BAVC for, you know, being able to host this amazing program for students. I would just like to give a specific special thanks to Valentina, Jay, Faye, Carolina, Joelle, David, Sarah, Paula, Dawn, Meg, and other BAVC staff. Thank you all so much.
Go back to where you came from. Speak English. Illegal.
No matter who we are all human beings. We should all be treated equally.
Mushroom, pen, pizza, people, paper, pizza, and pineapple,
blue,
charger,
purple, red, yellow,
eyebrows, purple,
eyes,
blue,
eyes,
sticky
cap,
notes,
with eyebrows,
mushroom,
pen,
pizza,
people,
paper,
pizza, and pineapple,
blue,
charger, purple,
red,
yellow,
eyebrows,
purple,
eyes,
blue,
eyes,
sticky
cap,
notes,
with eyebrows,
light,
eyebrows.
Red,
yellow.
Animation!
Oh my god, everybody! I know I watched you guys make it, but I'm still freaking out watching it now. I just want to reiterate that I'm so proud of every single one of you. Animation is not easy. It takes time and so much effort, and you guys, you did it. Like, you did that, plus everything else in your life. So just, like, I'm so in awe of all of you. Right, guys? Like, what the hell? Right?
Yeah.
My god.
That was crazy. I'm also, every single one of those was so different from the other. And so I don't understand how you all learned all of those skills and then had enough, like, time to create your own piece that was singular from all the other universes. I don't get it. I also, Valentino, don't get how you taught that class remotely. It's all so impressive. So bravo.
I blacked out the whole time. I don't remember how I did it.
Stop motion on an iPad.
Okay, before I start crying, up next we have the factory class. Take it away, y'all.
Right. Well, first of all, I just have to give another round of applause to all of the classes, Bump, Game Code, Animation. Those were beautiful. I officially want to take every class. I don't know if that's possible, Faye, so if you can get me in there, that would be great. but yeah, so I'll tell you guys a little bit about what we did in Factory this semester. We focused on cinematic storytelling, covered all aspects of film production, which includes the practices of pre-production, the fundamentals of camera operation, an overview of lighting and sound, and of course, basic editing principles. Translated into a virtual experience, the students truly were able to showcase their resilience and their own unique artistic perspectives to make their voices heard. The objective was to look at the process of producing media through a social justice lens and examine ways in which we can all tell our own personal narrative. Learning a craft like this, you know, virtually and staying engaged, not only like in learning, but with one another. You know, each student came to class equipped with fresh ideas and perspectives. And I think that really contributed to the richness of this whole experience, just really making it special. Every film you're going to see tonight is so, so different. And I think that really speaks to everyone truly honoring their own voice and being authentic in this process. And, you know, we celebrate you guys all tonight. So get out there and, like I told you, sissy that walk. First up, we've got Waverly.
Hi, my name is Waverly, and my short film is called I Need a Break, and it highlights how quarantine and 2021 have taken a toll on my mental health and how I cope with it. I would also like to thank the BAVC team for letting my annoying self come back. You guys are great. And yeah, that's it. Enjoy.
Night is approaching. The walls are caving in. Open, open, open. The aliens are after my Nutella. I must run.
You failed again, you foolish mortal.
No!
I hate high school.
And every day just feels the same.
They watch the same boring Zoom meetings, attend the same boring classes, listen to the same boring lectures, and do boring work until the day is finally over.
And that is it for today's class, everyone. Thank you for coming, and I'll see you guys tomorrow.
All my life, I've been a smart kid. Getting A's was easy, and I never faked my reading logs because I actually liked reading. Shocking. And then high school came, and all forms of motivation disappeared. COVID didn't make that any easier. Every day, I get reminded that I had it so much easier as a baby. I should have stayed in the womb if I knew life was gonna be like this. Now, I feel like I'm failing everyone around me, and I hate letting people down.
Type a short reflection of what you learned in class today. Okay, it shouldn't be hard. What I learned in class today was... No. In today's class, I learned that... Okay, what did I even learn? I'm so dead.
And here lies the ashes of my sister, Waverly Wong.
I can't do this!
Shut up!
Sorry!
Yeah, this isn't working. I need a break.
Everyone has different ways of distracting themselves, and mine is listening to music on walks. It's pretty therapeutic. I also like baking. Occasionally. And retail therapy. Buying food, clothes, anything. Spending money is fine. Only if you're rich, really. Otherwise, retail therapy is just a burden on your bank account. And that is not fun. Not to mention the feeling of receiving your package doesn't last very long. One look at your grades and all happiness fades. When you tie your academic intelligence to your value because it's the only thing you're good at and all you know, it's hard to detach. When you start to lose that intelligence, it feels like nothing you do will ever be enough. None of your coping mechanisms have taken away your problems, and at the end of the day, you are still sad. Growing up as a first-generation United States citizen in my family of immigrants, I feel that it's my job to make sure that I succeed so my parents can live comfortably after sacrificing so much for me. But I have no idea if I can even do that if my knowledge is so far behind in my classes and I end up failing my final exams.
Or maybe you should just stop doubting yourself. So what if you don't remember anything you learned at the beginning of the year? A lot of people don't. So just get to work!
You're right, Sandy. That was very inspirational.
I know. Also, you've gotta stop talking to stuffed animals. It's starting to get weird.
Right.
Amazing. Amazing, amazing, amazing. Waverly, you always know how to make me laugh. Yeah, I love that. So she does got jokes. Next up, I believe we have Evan.
Hi, my name is Evan. My film is called Laranja, which is Chinese for elders, which is who the film is. Thank you.
Thank you.
amazing. Thank you so much, Evan. That was a beautiful film. Excuse me. Next up, we have Jackson.
Okay, so I'm Jackson, and my film is about how Tourette's syndrome works and like how it affects the people that like have it. Tourette's syndrome is a disorder that causes someone to feel the need to make specific movements or sounds. Most of the time, it is very hard not to make the sound or motion, and not doing it can cause great discomfort. There are more than 200,000 cases discovered in the U.S. every year, so it's relatively common. It is incurable, but it can be treated by doing exercises to help retrain your brain. Kids usually start to show signs of Tourette's syndrome when they are around 2 to 15 years old, and it can usually last for many years to a lifetime. Here's an interview with my brother who has Tourette's syndrome.
Do your tics hurt?
No, they don't. They kind of just feel uncomfortable.
So, like what do you mean by, like, what do you mean by uncomfortable? Is it kind of like a feeling?
It's like a sensation, like when you have to itch, almost. It's basically like a really bad itch that gets worse as you wait.
Could you relate it to, like, that feeling when you need to swallow and the more and more you pull
out? Yes, it's very much like that.
It's kind of just like that feeling when you need to swallow, but, like, so... Let's say like you're holding a swallow, right? Mm-hmm. The more and more you hold in, there's more and more that need to do it, right?
Yes.
And it eventually just happens by itself. Yeah. Like there's no control. It's kind of like that.
Well, it's like, for tics, it doesn't really happen by itself. It's like, I need it to happen. Otherwise, I feel like I'm like, gonna like, pop or something.
Okay. Do you kind of know in advance why it's gonna happen? Like, oh, I'm gonna need to take it a second, like that?
Like, looks like this, mm-hmm. I get the sensation, it's like, okay, I have to take now.
Like there.
Yeah. Okay. Like I felt a need.
Okay.
And I know this isn't a question, but sometimes when it's like I talk about the tics, I really tend to notice them. Like, they come up.
Like how do your tics affect like your daily life? Like how do your tics make normal things in your life any different from people without tics?
Well, I mean, this is pretty like minuscule stuff that doesn't really affect me often. But if sometimes with my friends I try to do silence challenges, you can stay silent the longest. Uh-huh. And I'm always the first one out.
Okay.
And then also, this one was affecting me so much when I was younger. I just couldn't play hide and seek. Like, I couldn't be the hider. Because I was always the first one found.
So it seems like more if it's just, you know, if you're trying not to make sound, it's kind of hard not to.
Yeah. It's like, it doesn't really like affect me in a very bad way, but just because I don't have very like, physical tics. Like, there's people with way worse tics than I do. I just got vocal ones. There's people who have tics, like, they might need to go, like, this or something every now and then. Or, like, do some sudden motion every now and then.
Okay.
All right, really awesome job. Thank you so much, Jackson. Up next, we have got Angelo.
Hi, my name is Angelo. My film is a short film documentary about the Tenderloin neighborhood that showcases the homeless community, poverty, and what it's like to be in this notorious neighborhood. It's also supposed to motivate and give tips on how you can help communities around you who are in need.
Tenderloin is a melting pot of offenders from out of town, even out of state.
Setting up shop here in the Bay Area and peddling their drugs here in the Tenderloin.
This evening, police responded to reports of
Tenderloin where five people have been shot. Chopper 5 showing us the scene.
A community with a reputation of violent street crimes, such as robbery and aggravated assault, is the same community that I've grown up in. This is the Tenderloin. located in the heart of downtown San Francisco. A car passes every now and then, witnessing the true natures of this neighborhood. The Tenderloin's silent scream for help is seen from outside of their window. These same cars just drive away, and hope is gone once again. Walking home from school, witnessing things such as drugs, poverty, homeless people, and families who are just trying to get by is my normal. Growing up, I never really thought about the homeless people on the streets and usually just walk past them. I've noticed that a lot of people just walk past the homeless communities, and not just my neighborhood, but various other neighborhoods. In places of poverty and homelessness, we normalize this situation, and because it's so normal, we end up not taking any action. Instead, we just walk by without thinking much about it. Why do we walk past the homeless community? We walk past them because we feel as though they aren't important and we can't do anything about their situation. The truth is that we can. Every homeless person has been through their own struggle and have different reasons for why they ended up homeless. We as people need to take the initiative to help out not just our community, but other communities who are in need of our help. If we continue to ignore what's right in front of us and walk past these communities, all we're doing is continuing to normalize the situation. We need to step up and take action. There's organizations like St. Anthony's, based in the heart of the Tenderloin, that provide essential support to people in San Francisco that are living in poverty. They serve around 2,400 meals, provide 150 people with fresh and new clothing, and support 70 people with addiction recovery services every single day. There are organizations and people similar to St. Anthony's all around the world who are helping communities that are struggling. Every small act can make a big difference, and it all starts with you. The question you need to ask yourself is, what can you do to help your community? I'll help you get started. Here are 5 ways to help out the homeless community. 1. Make cards to promote nearby homeless shelters. 2. Donate clothes to your local homeless shelter. 3. Start your own clothing drive in your community. 4. Volunteer your time at homeless shelters. 5. Spread the word to your friends and help out together. You can be that change that your community or other communities need.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Angelo. That was beautiful. Up next, we've got Nupisa.
Hi, my name is Nupisa, and I chose to make my video on food deserts. Food deserts exist all over the United States, and food has a large effect on everyone's quality of life, and having access to high-quality food will help us all live a long-lasting, balanced life, which all people have a right to. Many of us are used to simply walking or driving to a nearby grocery store to grab groceries. A lot of us are very familiar with the experience of shopping for fresh produce that is extremely accessible to us. Some people may cook an extremely intensive meal, and others might opt for a quick 10-minute recipe. These are very simple things that many of us do on a regular basis, to the point where we tend to look past it as a regular thing in our daily lives. Now imagine that all of the grocery stores nearby suddenly got 1 hour farther away from you, and now they have all been replaced by fast food chains. You no longer have a quick mode of transportation, and the public transportation in your city is generally unreliable, and it would take you twice as long to go to the grocery store. It is now dinner time, and you have 2 options. Do you make that trip to the grocery store after a long day of work? You're tired and you're hungry and you just want some food in your stomach? Or do you just opt for that quick easy, and most of all, accessible option to buy junk food, regardless of its healthiness. Many of us might choose the junk food option and go to a fast food chain. Now make this your daily routine. It becomes repetitive and happens more often than you would like. This is just one of the examples of the choices that must be made by roughly 23 million people living in food deserts within the United States. Nearly half of those people are low income. Food deserts are areas which have limited or no access to grocery stores. They can exist anywhere, within a rural or urban area, but generally areas with more poverty. An example of this within a largely urban city would be the city of Houston, Texas, where there are more than 2 million people living there. However, it is estimated that over 500,000 people within the greater Houston area live within a food desert. Food deserts result in a lack of secure access to nutritious food for people to be able to have a well-balanced, healthy, long-lasting lifestyle. In other words, food insecurity. Within these food deserts, there are fast food chains and stores which sell things at discount prices, which usually do not sell fresh produce or healthy products either. Food deserts and food insecurity directly impacts one's quality of life and their health. To rid of these food deserts, we need to put an emphasis on the fact that food is a fundamental human right, and all people, regardless of their income, deserve access to nutritious food that will help them live a very long and healthy life.
All right. Yes, new piece. I love it. Now you made me hungry. Thanks a lot. Up next, we've got Maddie.
Hi, my name is Maddie. And first, I want to just thank Jess for all of her support making this. I genuinely don't know where this film would be without all of her help. And yeah, this is my second time doing BAVC, and it's genuinely such like a fulfilling and fun experience. And basically, my film is about gender and race discrepancies in various areas of STEM research, and kind of how that plays and feeds into like healthcare systems. And yeah, I learned a lot while making this, so I hope you all walk away learning something new too.
Anyone who isn't a cisgender man can probably agree we're walking through a world made by men for men. Gender inequalities seep their way into our everyday lives through gaps in pay, work and education opportunities, and stifling gender norms. But what about our health? What about the research that goes on behind the scenes? What if I told you that simply because you are born in a female body, you are 17% more likely than a male-bodied person to die in a car crash, and 73% more likely to be severely injured? Simply because your body type isn't once considered when seatbelts are designed, and the crash test dummies used to ensure your safety are only made to look like the average male? What has this resulted in? 4 decades worth of deadly consequences.
There's a lot of bias just tied up into different clinical systems, whether you're talking about healthcare or research, all of those fields have their own nuances around how gender is allowed to have efficacy. Oftentimes, healthy, young, white men are the people that get the trials or tested. Results, it might not be as representative for women.
These discrepancies expand past just the research and trial processes. Differences in sex discovered in medical research and clinical trials are often ignored when applied to everyday practices. This causes a chain reaction throughout the entire system, causing female perspectives to be disregarded in medical standards, practice, and training. Proper representation lacks in research regarding heart disease, lung cancer, depression, and Alzheimer's disease. The majority of heart disease research has favored male subjects, despite it being the leading cause of female mortality since 1989.
If heart disease is the number one killer of women, we're not having those discussions as frequently. There's still a lot of differential thought between how a heart attack presents in a woman. It may look really different than how it presents in a man.
Extremely low rates of women of color are represented in Alzheimer's treatment research. In a 2017 trial for a drug to treat the disease, only 1.6% of subjects were African American women, even when they are two times more likely to develop the disease. These ironies negatively affect the efficacy of research and treatments for cisgender women.
When we talk about diversity and inclusion, those are real, I don't want to say glass ceilings, because we always think about going upwards, but what we really want to think about is going outwards, right? So who are we including? That's where that power sharing needs to happen, or power giving even. And while things have changed greatly, I think in the last couple decades, we still see it in the data, either representing scientists in the field, there's such fewer women, but even people benefiting from certain types of research. There might be a study and it might be generalized to the population. However, the study itself was only done on young men, let's say. So it's really difficult to pierce through those details and to really see what's going on in here. Do the findings really pertain to me? I think we need a little bit more transparency in that, honestly.
All of these inequities originate from years of misogynistic biases in the STEM field. For decades, women were exclusively left out of research because white males were considered the normal study population. Bias against women's attitudes during the trial process, and researchers viewed women as confusing and expensive due to our unpredictable hormonal levels. These biases still creep their way into modern medicine. The idea of women needing their own research is not widely accepted, and race, sex, and gender have yet to be integrated into all areas of research.
And there are many fields that are not very progressive. I always explain to my students, bias is the same thing as error. If you have bias in a study, you have error in your study. And so I want us to think about bias as an error, right? If we favor boys over girls, that's an error. If we favor certain races over another, those are errors.
The only way to further advance and protect women's health is through promoting equity throughout research requirements, design, and analysis of clinical trials. In this time where the health of ourselves and our friends and family is such a huge concern, we should be asking what kind of research influences today's medical standards. These gaps in research have threatened the health of women for generations, and the lack of change will affect numerous generations to come. Female health can no longer be viewed as something secondary or something that can be left to chance. It is vital that race, sex, and gender-based research becomes the norm and no longer the exception.
Amazing, Maddie. I'm so happy you were able to make that interview happen. Great job. So up next, we've got Sydney.
Hi, I'm Sydney, and my short story is about a rock named Sherlock whose mission is to save the world. And I just wanted to say thank you just so much for all your resources. And the animation teacher, thank you for helping me too.
Hello, I'm Sherlock the Rock.
I know I may only be a rock, but I'm going to make it my mission to save the world. You may be wondering, Sherlock, how come you're so passionate about saving the world? You outlive all of us. You've got it made. Well, you see, a day in the life of a rock is a lot of sitting and observing. To be honest, I want to do more than sit and observe. I'm going to take a stand. Besides, I quite enjoy the other inhabitants I share the earth with now, and I'm going to help them. I've grown quite tired of the objects that drop on me from far above. One of my plans is to start sorting the things that fall on me sometimes. That way the items can be properly disposed of and reused.
Who's he?
Oh, who? This fellow? I call him Alfred of Arrowhead. He is repurposed. You see, I hear there are other rocks like me. More extremist. I hear they propel themselves at cars to try to stop people from exerting some carbon emissions.
Sounds violent.
They mean well. Reusable bags are a good thing, too. I had made my own out of grass and twigs. I'm still experimenting to find the right materials. I can't do this alone, and my reusable bags simply aren't enough. I need your help. This is not what I meant.
Gosh, amazing, Sydney. Way to go for tackling stop motion, and big thanks to Valentina for that, for your help with that one. Really good stuff. All right, up next we've got Andrea.
Yeah, hi everyone, my name is Andrea and I interviewed my sister and cousin, and I just wanted to learn more about what it was like for them growing up as a Filipino and growing up in different environments. And also I'd like to thank Jess too for this, for helping us throughout this entire project. Really could not have done it at all without you, so thank you. Yeah, enjoy.
Hello.
Hi. My name is Ashley Driza. I'm 18 and I go by she, her.
And so I'm just gonna ask you like a few questions about where you grew up and what that was like, and just try to learn more about our culture through you.
I was born in the Philippines and I moved here when I was 10 with my sister and my dad.
So you grew up in the Philippines for about 10 years and now you're 18. In America, what differences have you kind of noticed?
There's a lot, but I guess like the culture and the people are different, because in America, obviously it's more diverse, especially in San Francisco. And in the Philippines, while I was growing up there, it was always like weird when you saw someone who wasn't Filipino. Personally, it's easier making friends within, like, when you were in the same ethnicity group. I didn't have to adjust to anything since everyone was kind of like me. And in America, when I moved here, I had to make friends with different cultures and ethnicities, which is like kind of a culture shock for me, because obviously growing up, it wasn't like I wasn't well aware of like the bigger world, I guess.
So what are some generational gaps or like patterns you've seen amongst like your culture that you'd wish to break.
One thing that's like really normalized is putting each other down. So yeah. There's like insane beauty standards. If you're too dark, then you're not considered beautiful. Or if you're mm-hmm. too thick or you're too thin.
So what is your relationship like with your family?
I'm not close with my family. Mm-hmm. I wish I was though. But I'd say I'm pretty close with my cousins and my sister. They're one of my biggest emotional support when I have problems. And they really help me.
What is something you like about your culture?
We're like really big on family. When I was growing up in the Philippines, if there was a party at the block, everyone would be at that party, and everyone yeah. would just treat everyone like they've known each other, even mm-hmm. though they wouldn't know each other.
That's kind of it.
Okay.
Thanks, cousin.
Yeah.
Where do you go? My name is Clarice, my age is 19, and my pronouns are she, her, hers.
And where were you born?
I was born in Palo Alto, California.
So what was it like growing up in America as a Filipino-American?
Well, growing up it was really hard to kind of create an identity for myself, which I guess is what a lot of kids go through. You know, I think it's really hard to find a young person who has their identity figured out, but I think for me it was especially confusing because I never really felt like I fit in anywhere. You know, I didn't fit in with the Asian community because there was a lack of... I didn't really grow up around a lot of Filipinos besides my family, and so it was kind of hard finding people who really understood me and who understood my struggles. Like, I just remember one time my mom was so excited to bring me this Filipino dish, and she was so excited that she had time off work to, you know, actually like bring it to me during my lunchtime. But all I could think about was, you know, like being embarrassed that kids would think it was stinky, or like, oh, like I remember kids saying that it looked weird and blah blah blah. And after that, like, I just wanted my mom to pack me sandwiches. But then after transferring schools, I went to a school that had a bigger Asian population, and, you know, obviously I felt more comfortable bringing rice to school and, like, eating what I normally would at home, but still, I didn't really have, like, a Filipino community, which really sucked. But I think over time, I'm grateful that I was exposed to a lot of different communities, because it made me a lot more empathetic, but also kind of showed me that, you know, like, my culture is really important too, and like it's that much important for me to kind of like keep it alive.
What is something you like about your culture?
Well, besides the food, I love how hospitable we are. Like, I feel like, you know, even though in some areas there aren't a lot of Filipinos, like, the great thing is that when you do find someone who is Filipino, then it's like you already have something to talk about, you know?
Some generational gaps or patterns you've seen amongst your culture that you wish to break for the future generation?
There's still that idea that, you know, men are the breadwinners, and they're also like the head of the family who gets a say in everything, and then the women are just expected to, you know, clean and cook. And obviously, like, today, those gender roles and norms have changed a lot, but you still see a lot of the same old toxic beliefs, like, you know, maybe wives do have jobs now and do have a say in certain things financially, but then you'll also see that they're still expected to clean, they're still expected to do all the cooking, and it's like the responsibility is not 50-50, so you'll definitely see that. And the same with the eldest daughter, like, a lot of responsibility is put on the eldest daughter, and it's almost like they're, you know, the second mother. which isn't typically addressed, but yeah.
So those are all my questions. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
No.
Thank you so much, Andrea. I especially love seeing that footage of you having such a great time at the end. Really cool. Awesome. Thank you. Up next, we have Ariana.
Okay. Hi, guys. My name is Ariana, and my short film is called Inside and Out, and it's basically about mental health and how it can help the people who are struggling. And being in factory at BAVC has been an amazing experience, and it was a great opportunity. I love being a part of something beautiful, and I just want to say thank you for the people at BAVC, and thank you, Jess, for being supportive and helpful.
More than half of all Americans will be diagnosed with a mental illness. Nonetheless, not everyone will receive the assistance they need. Of grown-ups, 50% of youth receive the necessary medical help. Ignoring the fact that mental illness is common and can affect anyone, there is still a substantial stigma attached to it. This stigma builds apprehension and shame in seeking help. Substance abuse, self-harm, and suicide are all serious and dangerous behaviors. In individuals who are suffering from various illnesses, the embarrassment, shame, and guilt that surround mental illness prevent people from getting the help they need to recover and cause them to hide their pain. Mental illness should not be something to be ashamed or stigmatized. When mental illness is treated as seriously as other illnesses, an increasing number of people will find the courage to seek help and improve their lives. Receiving support is largely an important thing a person can do for themselves. But developments can be made. Talking to someone is often the first step to take when you know they are going through a hard time. Have time for that person and don't predict their feelings. It may also be beneficial to provide them with contact information for organizations or individuals to whom they can reach out. This way you can find out what is troubling them and what you can do to help. Thank you. that needs to be cared for.
All right, Ariana. Amazing. Really beautiful film. Thank you so much. Up next, we have got Rachel.
In March 2020, a pandemic was declared in the United States. Restaurants and schools closed throughout the nation, and our definition of a normal life started to change. As the number of COVID cases started to increase, Asian Americans were used as scapegoats for the cause of the pandemic. Just because our former president couldn't keep the virus under control and constantly caught the virus,
the Chinese virus, Kung Flu,
does not excuse any of the racism or xenophobia towards Asian Americans. According to analysis conducted by AAPI hate organization, 1 in 10 tweets about Asian Americans by politicians contain racist and stigmatizing comments about China. 98% of those tweets blame China for the pandemic. Anti-Asian hate crimes have risen nearly 150% during the pandemic.
Step forward and slash
me. A man walked up behind a 91-year-old
investigating
man.
Another attack on an Asian American person in Northern California.
The video was taken at a laundromat near San Francisco's Chinatown on February 23rd. Three suspects ambushed the 67-year-old man.
He walked in his neighborhood park. The suspect didn't try to rob him. Her dad ended up in the hospital with a brain injury.
Because there are fears this morning that a string of deadly shootings at massage parlors in the Atlanta area could be linked to a wave of attacks against Asian Americans.
One of the countless examples of racism against Asian Americans happened on March 16th, where six Asian women were murdered at three different spas in Atlanta. Asian women have been faced with abuse, exploitation, and being fetishized since the 18th century. Law enforcement has failed to characterize the shooting as a hate crime. Instead, they came out with this statement.
As the chief said, this is still early, but he does claim that it was not racially motivated. He apparently has an issue, what he considers a sex conviction, and sees these locations as something that allows him to go to these places, and it's a temptation for him that he wanted to eliminate. And he was pretty much fed up and kind of at the end of his rope, and yesterday was a really bad day for him, and this is what he did.
A sex addict that wanted to stop his temptation caused the lives of 8 people. This was indeed a hate crime that contributes to the history of perceiving Asian women as sexual objects. Hypersexualization against Asian women is a big part of the racism against Asian Americans. To say that he was trying to eliminate his addiction to justify his terrorist act is complete BS. There are also many hate crimes that are being undocumented. This may be because Asian Americans are reluctant to contact law enforcement due to language or cultural barriers, distrust of police, or fear of repercussions for their immigration status. Many friends and families of mine have expressed their fear of going outside. My grandpa, who often likes to take walks around Chinatown, can no longer do so due to the fear of being attacked. There are many hate crimes occurring, especially in San Francisco. I want my friends and family members to be able to go out without the thought of being a victim of another hate crime. Many Asian Americans have joined together in solidarity to speak up about the issue by protesting and posting on social media platforms. Till this day, Asian Americans have to defend that they belong in this country.
All right, Rachel, amazing. Sorry about that, everybody. Rachel was having some mic issues in the beginning. But yeah, really grateful you got to show your film, Rachel. Amazing work. Okay, so next up we have Brianna.
Hi, my name is Brianna, and my film is an informative film about homelessness and how it can affect anyone. I'll also give you some ideas about how you can support and make a difference.
Steal things from yourself, you're usually doing it to somebody else at the same time. And you, what goes around comes around. So it can happen to you at any time according to what you've done. I did stupid things to myself. I've been rich. I've driven nice cars, nice houses. But when you get to the point where you really don't think you're getting anywhere and you're losing connections with people, like with alcohol or any substance accordingly. Mine was alcohol. And it just drove me to be self-contained, and I ran my life. I didn't make any friends. I don't have any family. I lost those when I was a kid. Things from yourself.
Open the gates for homelessness. One of the causes and effects of homelessness is a lack of adequate income, no affordable housing, rent discrimination, a lack of education, relationships that did not work out. Problems with mental health, as well as physical and mental abuse, lack of access to healthcare, is created worse by living in rough conditions, such as staying outside in all weather types, eating cheap chemical foods which end up with poor mental state, hygiene, and physical health. This can all cause someone to have trauma. Substance abuse, physical and mental illnesses are more common among homeless people than in the general population. There are more than 5,000 homeless people in the United States. Children make up 1/4 of homeless population. Hundreds of thousands of veterans are evicted from their homes. Domestic abuse is a major contributor to women's homelessness. One of the most significant causes of male homelessness is military services. Statistics on child homelessness paint a bleak picture. Unhappy family or household circumstances are affecting an increasing number of children, whether they have to flee their home to avoid unfair treatment or are left in limbo when their parents are unable to make payments. Homeless children account for approximately 1 in every 5 homeless people. Youth on the streets are more likely to become homeless as a result of a conflict with their parents. In more than 4 out of 10 cases, their sexual orientation is a contributing factor to their homelessness. Parents who reject LGBTQ children tend to escalate the situation, resulting in a high number of homeless LGBTQ youth. The District of Columbia, New York, Hawaii, Oregon, and California have the highest number of homeless people. Homelessness rates in those states are up to 5.8 times higher than national average. Open the gates for homelessness. According to the federal report, California homeless population was 161,548 in January 2020 prior to the pandemic, a 7% increase from 2019. Over the same time period, the number in Los Angeles County increased by 13% to 66,436 by January 2020. Helping another human being wouldn't hurt, so take the time out of your day to help improve the community. There are many ways to help homeless people. Most of the time, homelessness is just temporary. Sometimes all they require is someone to assist them getting back on their feet, and I believe that you can help homeless people just by leading them in the right direction. We are happiest when we are able to assist others. There is no greater joy than putting a smile on someone's face or assisting someone in need. Compassion does more than boost feelings of well-being. It can also turn feelings of stress, depression, into a pleasure and happiness. Some ways to help and support is organizing a fundraiser using social media and ideas such as a GoFundMe page. In-person events such as bake sales and school campaigns are also possible options. Another option is to donate clothes and shoes rather than throw them away. Volunteer and raise awareness. This will make you smile and feel happy. Take the time to learn about the youth shelters and homeless services organizations in your area, as well as the types of donations and volunteer efforts they require.
Really great. Thank you so much for sharing all of that information there as well. And last but not least, we have got Safa. All right, I think Safa might have, I think she told me her computer died. Sorry about that. All right, let's get into it.
Remember that one time you fell and everyone got it on video?
Hi! Oh!
Remember when you were crying and looked like a raccoon?
That's pathetic.
Remember when...
Breathe!
Shut up!
You're just really ugly.
Your GPA is a 4.3, but you're still so...
You're worthless!
Your friends are only there because they pity you, not because they like you.
Try cutting your hair instead of brushing it. Maybe it'll look nicer.
Did you actually think cutting your hair would make it look nicer?
It didn't. This is pathetic. This is pathetic. This is...
Remember your really ugly laugh?
Okay, I got it.
Okay.
No, I don't got it.
Remember when your uncle died and you laughed on the way to the funeral? Remember when?
You should lower your beauty standards. I'm no quick for Barbie. I was never thought out for from Queen. If I'm pretty, will you like me? They say beauty makes boys happy.
Let's go, Safa. And yeah, thank you to all of my students. Thank you for your kind words. Thank you for working so incredibly hard and really showing up and sharing your art today. Yeah, I love it. I can't say anything else. I'm going to cry.
Woohoo! Thank you, Jess. The convenient mute button for the crying portion of the evening. All right, we did it. Can you believe it? Great job, everybody. There truly is a virtual village of people that make this all happen, and thank yous are so important. We're grateful to so many people, all of our instructors, our youth programs team. Kato just arrived. She's in the house. Hello. We're so grateful to you. To our funders, our donors, we're grateful to all our guest speakers who showed up and dropped a lot of knowledge in our classrooms this semester. So grateful to our career panelists, also to DCUIF, so many funders and that. Kimball, Bothan, Dolby, oh my gosh, huge thank you to Dolby. Kara, who's with us tonight, has been screening all the videos, has been so helpful, and has been coming back for a couple semesters now to help us out with this. It's truly life-saving. We're so grateful. We actually have a couple last-minute announcements. Looks like we're getting out an hour early, so you can all celebrate yourselves with dinner, go celebrate the sunlight, still really bright outside. Kato, over to you with announcements.
Yes, okay, next slide, perfect. So our Summer Youth Media Intensive Making Program is still accepting applications. We have a couple spots left, so yes, apply. I'm gonna be putting in the chat a lot of links. So if you're interested, just on them and save them on your browser, and you have like 10 of them. But yes, so if you're interested in learning filmmaking, if you want to work on making two short films this summer, please, please,